Now, Triumph only made the TR4 for 5 years, from 1961 to 1965, knocking out around 40,000 cars. They then replaced it with a very similar-looking TR4A and added independent rear suspension. But this car, there's something I just love about it. I mean, forget for a second the price that Mike paid, criminal. This is a really good, honest, honourable version of a 64 TR4. And there's some other good things going for it. Number one, it's a California car and it's really dry here. Number two, it's been kept in a garage for 20 years. This exact same car in the UK, where it's nice and rainy, would absolutely mean I'd need both of those two welders to fix it because it would be littered with rust. But instead of rust, it's actually got this nice thin layer of oil over it. And what that's done is the oil's protected the car. It's kept it kind of honest. Any car that's been sitting idle for as long as this one has, even in a garage in California, will most likely have some dried up seals and hoses. Not to mention, you have to wonder why it was left parked in the first place. So going through the engine is a judicious move to get this Brit sports car back on the tarmac. A TR4A beat Ferrari at Daytona. Can you imagine that? A British sports car company handing it back to Enzo. They're also really popular today. If you go to race weekends, hill climbs, sprints, you'll see a number of TR4s. Why? Because they're really good cars. Now, the heart of this great car is, of course, this engine. 2.1 litre, overhead valve, twin SUs, 100 horsepower, and it is relatively straightforward. In fact, this is basically tractor technology. Along with the engine, the gearbox will also have to come out. It's just a few more bolts, and at this point, there's certainly no need to leave it in. So I've been dragging engines out of cars for years, and you always get that monumental sense of achievement. On top of the dried out seals and hoses, it's probably a good idea to at least inspect the major components, like the clutch and flywheel, while I've got the engine and gearbox out. Pretty grimy in there. Yeah, that clutch has seen better days. Now, it might seem kind of odd, but actually, I kind of like cleaning engines. This hands-on process is also quite intimate. You get to learn every single square inch of your engine. I'm so pleased with how the engine's come out. Well, I must admit, it took way longer than I expected. It was one of those jobs I just suddenly got in the zone, looked outside the door and then realised it was nighttime. But she is spectacular. Now, I kind of like this decade-old patina. It gives the engine a certain charm. But I have made a decision to paint the block. I'm going to give it a nice lick of satin black. But before I get my brushes out, I'm going to have to lose some of the gubbins. These carbs are Zenith Strombergs. They're part of the reason why this engine's so reliable. Now, these don't need a rebuild. In fact, Mike says they ran really nicely. But while they're off the car, I think I'm going to swap out a few seals, which I'll tackle later. Now, one of the most interesting things about this engine is actually what's going on inside here, the bit that you can't see. And that's because each cylinder, and there's four of them, has a removable liner. So instead of casting a block out of solid steel and then machining four cylinders into it, you still have four cavities, but each cavity is taken up with a sleeve. And it's inside that sleeve the piston operates. Now, the sleeves themselves are actually just a hand press fit. What that means is race teams could easily swap them out, but bigger sleeves in bigger pistons increase the cubic capacity in very short order. Now, the standard motor company adopted the sleeve idea for mass-produced, low-cost engines. Because what that meant is that they could produce a one-off engine block and then make changes just by adding different sleeves and different pistons. And what that also meant is that home builders could make upgrades as well. Get your standard engine, upgrade the pistons, and give your engine more power. As I remove components to isolate the block and get it ready for paint, I'm able to closely inspect parts and decide what needs replacing and what's suitable to simply clean and reinstall. Most elements of the cooling system are inexpensive enough that it will make sense to replace and start afresh. Now, I'm not actually going to be separating the head off the block. Mike didn't report any head gasket issues. And actually, there is zero evidence of any head gasket issues. So I'm not going to even open up that can of worms. I've got plenty of work to do already. It's amazing what a coat of paint can do. And it's hard to believe that this started out its life as a tractor engine. Now, as a restorer, this is probably my favourite part of any restoration. All my parts are laid out, polished, painted, and ready to refit. The TR4 motor is a real piece of utilitarian art. No superfluous gadgetry that you'd find on a new car, just real old-school mechanical reliability. From its double timing chain to its simple spring tensioners, this engine is a true workhorse. Now, before I refit the sump, the reason I'm here in the first place is here, the rear mainsail. I've done a ton of rear mainsails, and normally you just take the gearbox off, lose the clutch and the flywheel to get access to it. But on this engine, unfortunately, you have to leave the sump off because I'm releasing this main cap here. Now, check this out. See, this setup here, this is actually called a scroll seal. There's no rubber, it's actually metal-to-metal contact. This can last for many years, but there is a new option which incorporates a new technology. Now, it still has a pair of outer shells, just like the original, but it has this extra layer here in the middle. It's kind of a bit more like a conventional rear mainsail. See, a normal mainsail is a complete circle and you would tap it onto the crank, but this one has to be wrapped around the crank because of the way it's designed. Well, I'm lucky that this aftermarket kit exists. Otherwise, the crank would probably have to come out for machining. Although there are some purists out there that like doing that extra step to keep it stock. Right, next up is my more modern water pump, which is this one here. Now, if you notice on this one, there's six vanes and they're all at an angle. See, this base here, this is enough to create centrifugal forces as it's spinning in line with the engine, and that allows pressure within the system. This alone, this tiny little space, pressurizes and feeds coolant to the entire engine. This is a nice little upgrade.
An efficient water pump helps the car run cooler, which can not only prolong engine life, but it can also help with power and overall engine and fuel efficiency. Once we get the new gaskets on the thermostat housing, the entire engine side of the cooling system will now be properly sealed.
Having a lightened flywheel allows the engine to rev up quicker and will give our car a more spirited drive. Remember, this is a TR4. A car with racing heritage. You can imagine you want to attack all those country lanes, those curves, using the gears, like a racing driver.
With the new flywheel in place, I'm now going to add a new clutch. And finally, I fit a now super clean gearbox, and then I'm ready to refit the engine.
Click here to subscribe.